Okay, my name is Daniel Elfstrand, and I'm working at Volvo Cars. I've been working at Volvo Cars for a very, very long time, but I've been there for in different positions. I've been working within product development, within manufacturing, in within IT for the last 15 years. And also in IT, I've been to operations, I've been to development, IT strategies, and right now I'm working with as a transformation manager. I actually started to exercise DevOps 25 years ago, but it was not within IT, but I will come back to that. So just very briefly around Volvo Cars. We are a company that's in a very good flow for the moment. We're growing. Our products is selling very good, and also some awards. We're expanding in the sense that we're building new plants in China, US. But also within IT has been a lot of more focused. So we also now have an IT office over at Silicon Valley, as well as in Sweden and in China. we had record sales last year. And it's, I think it's really interesting times in automotive for the moment. So many things happen at the same time. I think the last century, or the last 100 years, nothing so happened so much with the cars, more than it was just improvement of fuel consumption, around handling and those things. And suddenly during the last kind of 5 years, it's coming in, and now for the future, everything from infotainment, connected cars, autonomous drive, electrification. So it's really, really interesting business for the moment. So the first question, actually, myself and probably everyone should ask ourselves is that, why should we do anything differently? Doesn't it work well, what we're doing today? And of course, most people talk about pace and time to market. Everything has to be faster. You need internet, faster internet. Everything should be faster. I think from my side, it's really around customer experience. Customer experience is that it's feedback from the customers, be responsive to that feedback, and the customer feels important that their feedback is being incorporated. I think it's worth to mention as well that companies like Volvo Cars, as many other, are also changing business models. And they're going from a B2B model into a business-to-consumer model. And that's quite new for many companies, but I think it's a general trend within automotive and other areas as well. And it means that the customer, we have more direct connection with the customers than we had in the past. Before, it was always the dealers between us and the consumers. I also think it's important when it comes to doing things differently, it's coming back to software development in the cars. We've been doing agile development in product development for a number of years, but it has to be more than that, and I will come back to that. And I think it was interesting when our CEO, Håkan Samuelsson, actually put on Twitter that why don't we develop IT system in a similar way that we're developing products with passionate ownership. And I think that's, he's a very good supporter in this area in general. And I think that he also talked about how software delivery has to be a key capability of the company. So what are we actually talking about? There's a lot of buzzwords out there. Probably don't even have 10% of them, but it's a lot of buzzwords. Some companies and some people focusing more on a few of these. It might be around test automation, deployment automation. It might be around practices and Scrum and all these things. But if we look on top here, and I've seen this in other presentations as well, it usually boils down to the three areas or three categories, process, people, and technology. And all these things is in general, I would say, an evolution, and I will come back to that. But we need to understand that there is a paradigm shift going on, and it's impacting not just IT. This is not a transformation that only can be done by IT. It's around the whole enterprise, really. So it's around business, it's around the financial organization, and how to deal with a lot of new things coming in here. So if we start backwards in this, from this picture around technology and technology shift, I don't see that many 20-year-old people in here. So I guess that most of you are at least familiar with mainframe and those things. But this is very high level, and I think it's quite interesting because if you see that the shift in technology has went from the mainframe back in the 70s and 80s into the client-server area, a lot of monolith applications, and now we come into the cloud area when we talk about infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, and software as a service. Some people react when I show this picture, well, Daniel, somehow I see a recognize between mainframe and cloud. And it's correct. The main difference is really that back in the mainframe you had 3217 green screens, and now today you have a web browser instead. But from an architectural perspective, it's a lot of similarities. And actually, we have people in our mainframe team that's probably most mature when it comes to the mindset and thinking of DevOps, because they've been working that way back since the, at least the 90s. So development and operations have been the same team all the time, even though they haven't been running Scrum, for instance. But that's what we're looking into for the moment. There's other things around technology as well when it comes to automation. And that's probably the, one of the biggest differences, especially compared to 2010 and 20 years back. It's around how you can automate, and you can compare this with the robots in the plants back in the 70s and 80s as well. How you replace and you can execute the same things over and over and over again and exactly the same with the same quality. So I think automation is, of course, a key enabler here when it comes to technology. Another thing is around practices. Agile Manifesto was out there in 2001, and then it's been an evolution from agile development into continuous integration, continuous delivery, into DevOps. But it couldn't, it's not just about working methods, because again, the technology has enabled new ways of working. So this has been very tightly connected, how we improve, and you can see this as kind of continuous improvement itself, stepwise, back from the Agile Manifesto. And I think, at least at Volvo Cars, we've been focusing quite much on these two things. I haven't mentioned, and maybe I should mention, that we have roughly 14 teams running. Some of them are actually in DevOps, and some are in transition from agile development into DevOps. And they are, so we have the practice and we have the tools. but the question is really, is this all? Is it enough with only having guidelines how to do this, running Scrum and using the right tools? And I think what we're missing sometimes is around, especially around mindset. And this is broader than just the teams. And at least many things can be talked about, values and mindset. But two important things from my side is around the change. Instead of talking about activities, measuring activities, and talking about business value and outcome, and also measuring deliverables instead of activities. And still a lot of people, especially if I put it in the context of middle management, want to see and understand activities being done. Instead, they should ask about which value. And I think it's very interesting because I have a two team myself I look after when it comes to agile developers, and they come to me all the time. Daniel, what's the value of what we're developing? So they want to understand the whole chain. Why are they developing? And for me, it's a fundamental difference between a programmer and an agile developer. And I really see that when we have different kind of teams here. But for them, it's not the coding that's the interesting thing, it's the value it will bring. The other thing I think is important is around the fundamental concept of minimal viable product. I've seen studies that talks about 40, 50% of functions and features have never been used in applications. And I can't find any other good word than waste and muda when it comes to that thinking. So think about all the value you could brought if you're doing the right things. Hence the whole principle around minimal viable product. Start small and just continue improve and work with the business around what are the most important things all the time. And that's coming back to prioritization as well. And these two things is in people's head. You need to understand the fundamental difference in thinking here. So all the bits and pieces together here, if I'm trying in this context, summarize and why I think we need to understand the paradigm shift. It's really around the four pieces here. It's around the culture. Everyone talks about the culture, but it's so important when it comes to mindset, values, beliefs, attitudes. It's around competence. I just took the example about programmer versus agile developers. We need to understand that the project manager is not automatically a scrum master. So it's really around competence and the right competences here as well. Practices is how to execute things. We using IT in part of the organization. In DevOps, those practices, we still need to execute something that covers incident management, event management, problem management, but in a different way. So it happens to be called post-mortem in problem management in DevOps. But in principle, it's also how you execute these things. And then we have technology that's primarily around, for me, an enabler, how we do executing. And I can take an example, actually, that we have a good example about the monolith, where we have four different teams. And so we don't have the right technology, but we have all the other three pieces. But of course, it can only take us to a certain point, because we have four different teams working in the same monolithic application. And there is a challenge around release planning and all these things, of course, when you need to bring these things together. And regarding these different cases, so again, for me, bringing these things together, that's really the shift. And it can't be done over a weekend, and it takes time, and you can't focus only on one of them. You need somehow to find a way to work in parallel. Then it's come to the question about, so can we find one model that works for everyone? And just to highlight, and if I would be representing a startup, that probably would be nice, and you know, only one product team or two product teams, and we can work with the same model. But in a large company, that's really the case. And I've taken a few examples here. So actually, I should start with case four, DevOps for a cloud-native application, Greenfield. That's when you have all the opportunities to start with microservice architecture. You can do it the right thing, right start from the beginning. So that's where everyone put in the focus, because you assume when everyone talks about DevOps that you do coding and software delivery. But then we have other cases here, and we have both applications. So we're actually using both SAP that's here, and we're using Siemens PLM as well. So both applications. Can we run DevOps then if we buy an application? Yes, we can. That's what we think, because we talk about configurations. We still need to do enhancements. We need to do different changes to that environment as well. So maybe it's not so much about checking in code and building code, but it's still DevOps, how you do fast feedback loops and come to the change of the configuration. We have the monolithic application. I took the example recently, just before there. And also mainframe. And again, that's where I think we're most mature, but we have different, slightly different tool chain, and we're trying to improve around Scrum and those practices there as well. Another dimension here, because we, as many other companies during the last 15 years, I would say, have been doing a lot of outsourcing, and of course that's coming up in this context. How can we do DevOps with outsourcing? And the first case is really where we want to be, or at least today, because it simplifies when you can co-locate teams on-premise and doing in-house development. But of course, we're using consultants and also from our strategic partners in that context. The second case is really if we buy a complete team, but still they're doing on-premise. So at least they are close to the product owner. And then the biggest challenged case is really about offshoring. So we do have cases covering more or less all these different scenarios. And I won't go through about the characteristics and all the experience behind it. But the most important outcome from here is that it's not one size fits all. We need to understand the different flavors and that we need to cover different variations here. So some examples about what the value that we got out from here in the current transformation. I won't show you that we're shipping software 100 times faster and all these things, but we are faster. We can see that. We can see that we're getting an increase of customer satisfaction from those areas. But I think there are also more soft values, increased transparency, because the discussion is much more about the value, about the different applications and different areas. So instead of just talking about applications, we're talking about function, capabilities, and values. And I think just that discussion is very, very important itself. It's not just about if we should keep this application, should we remove it, should we rewrite it. It's around what value do we want this area to cover. Another interesting thing was that it was this typical separation between business and IT in one area. And the business just requested new features all the time. And all the bugs, that's your problem within IT. Then we agreed, and actually this area was a very tough area. It was a critical application. We had task force at least a few times per year because it was incidents and these things. What happened that we moved the responsibility for operations to the business. And the first thing the business says was that no more features until the bugs are fixed. Stability is number one, they said. Same day, it just switched the mindset. And I think it was a tremendous improvement because after that, we worked continuously with the bugs and got the time for the team to address and fix these things. And suddenly, we hardly have had any severe incidents in that application after that. So, another area I would like to share. If you read this text, it could be from any DevOps handbook. And I think this is the reason I mentioned I exercised DevOps 25 years ago, but it was not within IT. It was within manufacturing. So it's interesting how much similarities, everything about lean manufacturing, total quality management, total productive maintenance. I was myself working with plant maintenance at the time back in the 90s. And it was really around continuous improvements. We were data-driven, we were monitoring the lines, machines, to do predictive maintenance. And it's so many things that we can take just from there and into IT. And we think within IT that we are modern, and you know, we're just 25 years behind here in the thinking. We're actually running daily stand-ups in the plant. At every time they shift, change shift, they have a daily stand-up going through what's the problem, what have happened since last time, and so on. Also within product development, we've been doing cross-functional teams with different peoples, so you can say dev and ops, so we have cross-functional teams with manufacturing engineering, design engineers, purchasing, and everything. And actually, I think in product development, it's probably the biggest change right now. We're going into the next phase there. So they have been doing agile software development for a few years, but now they broaden this to the whole product development because they see the same demands on making things faster, supporting, someone mentioned Tesla here earlier, and they are doing agile software delivery as well. But now we talk about the whole product development, will be more agile. We have chosen to run using SAFe, Scale Agile Framework, to broaden this to almost 4,000 people. So we talk about value streams and product streams and how to develop the car in a more agile way. It's coming back to feedback as well, feedback loops from customers. So it's really, really interesting because it keeps coming back to the end user and the customer is the important thing. And we need to think much more outside in what they need and what they want instead of inside out, what we think we should deliver. some few lessons learned. Can probably talk about a long time about that, but I just took four small parts here. One that we learned is that we can't push the business, coming back that we at IT can't say we want to use Agile or DevOps in this area. We need to get the business on board. In best of cases, they are actually pulling us and they want to run and work Agile together with us. The other thing is start small, create a movement. Yes, we need to have executive management support, but they don't know how to do these things. Instead, we have really, really good, experienced Agile developers that are practitioners that can help out, and we need to get everyone to help out in this movement. And if we can show them how these things should be done. So it was a discussion yesterday as well in the icebreaker session around middle management. That's where we have a lot of the challenges. But I think if we can start also with the movement bottom up, that will help out also to break the silos and break the walls. We have done both cases when it comes to changing existing teams from the traditional ways of working into more agile ways of working. It takes time, but it's feasible. But we have also other cases where we come in doing a greenfield new developed application or a product, and we can bring in agile developers from day one. And it's so much faster and more simple to get going in those areas. Most important, there is no magic formula. I heard that from someone else as well here, around DevOps and Agile. And there isn't a template, a standard. I think more if we talk about IT, there is a certain way to do and follow. But in Agile and DevOps, it's so much more to think about. But these sessions are very, very helpful because we can share experience and you can bring from that one and that experience from that company, and you have some frameworks like Scale Agile Framework, Scrum Guide, Less, and so on to bring the bits and pieces, and then you create your model. I have just two more things, one slide and one short movie. I wanted to share the movie because we used it internally. We talk about digital products and around transformation, so it was a kind of internal marketing video for around agile development and digital products. So let's see if it works. Oops.
As digital technologies change and shape our enterprise universe, we need to evolve to explore new possibilities. Enterprise Digital Solutions enables creating, building, serving, and selling our fantastic cars. This is a reality moving and changing at unparalleled speed. Mobility will be a whole new ballgame. At Volvo, we have a plan to face this together. As we renew our focus on working together with passion, transparency and trust to make people's lives less complicated, we are exploring and expanding to a new world, one that will be filled with enterprise digital products, each of which will be focused on real business outcomes and led by a product owner. On this new world, there will no longer be a separation of business and IT. We will work together to create business impact and the best kick-ass solutions in the world. The pace will be high, it'll be thrilling, exhausting and fun. Together we can create real value. All of this starts with exploring the new world of enterprise digital products. So, what exactly is a digital product? It's the software providing the features a user needs across the end-to-end journey of a business activity to accomplish a business goal. While the existing systems are what enables the goal today, in a product they are only building blocks, which may change as we find better ways to meet the user's need. The product is led by a product owner who really understands users' needs and goals. Product owner is a visionary and entrepreneur, empowered to shape the product to achieve business goals by actively managing the product's features and interfaces, and adopts an agile mindset to inspire innovation and change. We will start exploring the new enterprise digital product world in stages. We'll start by first launching several pilot products, followed by other areas. The pilot products are pioneers that will start exploring the new world. The pioneers will share learnings to prepare the new world for other product teams to land, and also share the experiences with our current world as we coexist, making both a better place as we face the universe together. Stay tuned for more information as we explore this new world together.
Okay, I know time is up, but I just wanted to share one last slide, just to say, let you know that I'm very proud, actually, to work with Involved Cars and having a CEO that's very progressive, and one of the executive management corporate objective is to be employer of choice. And I think a lot of companies has that. But if we just look quickly around culture, leaders, and competence here, it fits so well into the mindset and thinking and values that we're trying to talk about when it comes to Agile and DevOps. So that's very good. So thank you very much. I think we're in the beginning of a very, very interesting journey. It probably goes for every one of us here. So thank you very much.